Chapter 3. She's right, Marshall said. Your mom and President Thornton would pay anything to get you back. Casey didn't say anything. She sat on the carpeted floor and hugged Natasha. The other kids sat near her. It was cold in the van, so they spread the packing quilts over their legs. The van roared on to no one knew where. What are we going to do? Marshall asked. I don't know, Casey said. My mom and the president probably aren't even home yet. They don't know we're gone. Dink thought about his father waiting for him at the hotel. Can I see your light? He asked Ruth Rose. He shone the tiny glow on his watch. It was 5 o'clock. My dad doesn't know we went to the White House. When we don't show up at 5, he'll call the cops. But how will the cops find us? They won't know where to look. The president can get an airplane, right? Marshall asked Casey. Or a helicopter? But it's snowing, Marsh, and we're in a white van. They'd never see us. Plus, it must be getting dark by now. I wish we could see out, Marshall said. I wonder where he's planning on taking us. Somewhere there's food, I hope, Josh muttered. Maybe Joel stopped for a burger, he said. Josh chuckled in the dark. Right, he'll go up to the counter and say, 5 orders of burgers, fries, and shakes, please. Better wrap them up to go. I'm kidnapping a bunch of kids. The kids stopped talking. Dink could hear the van's loud engine. Beneath him, he felt the vibration and hum of moving tires. His stomach growled. Thanks a lot, Josh. Now you made me hungry. At least we have these blankets. The van slowed, then made a turn. Dink could feel the difference. They had been humming along smoothly, and now the road seemed bumpier. I think we're on a back road now, he said to the others. If you drive out of downtown Washington, D.C., you can be in the country pretty fast, Casey said. We could be well into Virginia by now. The bumpy ride continued. The kids had to grab hold of the shelves to keep their balance. Dink checked his watch every few minutes, using Ruth Rose's penlight. It's almost 6 now, he told them. Suddenly, the van swerved sharply to the right. It seemed to go over a huge bump. The kids were thrown into the air, then landed together in a pile. Then Dink felt another rough bump, and the kids were hurled toward the crate. They stopped suddenly with a sharp jolt. The floor of the van was at a crazy angle, as if they had landed in a hole. Natasha was barking wildly. What in the world just happened? Josh asked. We've had an accident, Dink said. Listen, the motor stopped. Is everybody okay? I banged my arm, Josh said. How bad is it? I don't know. I don't think it's broken, Josh answered. The kids untangled themselves. Ruth Rose turned on her light. Is Natasha okay? I think so, Casey said. She's licking my face. Josh, take the light and make sure your arm is all right. No blood, he said. So we won't have to cut it off, Dink observed. Very amusing, Dinkus. I'm almost laughing. They sat still, waiting to see if the van would start up again. Guys, what if the driver comes back here to check on Natasha? If he does, we jump him, Josh said. If all 5 of us do it, he won't stand a chance. Then what? What do we do with them? We can tie him up like a Christmas present. I saw some wire on one of the shelves, Marshall said. The kids waited. They sat awkwardly on the tilted floor. Dink expected to hear something or to see the van's rear doors open, but nothing happened. Dink heard only breathing and saw only darkness. This doesn't make sense. What could he be doing up there? Do you think he just left? He could have decided to try to get help. I didn't hear the driver's door open, but he could be hurt. Maybe he hit his head when we stopped. Oh my goodness, maybe he died, Josh said. We're trapped in the snow with a dead body. He switched on Ruth Rose's light. The kids looked at each other nervously. Dink told himself there was no way Josh could be right. How could the driver have been killed? We didn't hear a crash, so he didn't hit a tree or another car. This is creepy. I'm getting out of here, Josh announced. He crawled uphill to the doors and tried to the inside handle. We're locked in. Marshall moved up next to Josh. I saw this in a movie, he said. We lie on our backs with our feet against the doors. Then we all kick the doors at the same time. Together, we should be strong enough to bust the lock. Let's try it, Ruth Rose said. We can't stay here forever. The kids lined up on their backs close to the doors. Everyone get ready. On 3. 1, 2, 3. 10 feet smashed against the doors. They flew open, letting a blast of snow and freezing air into the compartment. The kids stared outside, squinting into the snow that flew into their faces. It was almost completely dark. There were no streetlights. Dink couldn't even see the road they had been traveling on, but he did see a path of crushed snow that the van had plowed through. Dink saw tall, dark shadows not far from the van. He figured they were trees. Natasha began whimpering. Casey hugged the dog, keeping a hand on her collar. Where are we? Josh asked. Out in the middle of nowhere, Marshall answered. We should go check on the driver. Wait, he could be dangerous. What if he's got a gun? Josh, he's a florist. A florist who kidnaps dogs. Maybe he has a glue gun, Dink said with a giggle. He felt silly, and he knew it was because he was so scared. Casey jumped out into the snow. The other four kids followed. Wind howled out of the darkness, shooting stinging snow into their faces. Don't shut the doors, Josh said. We don't want to get trapped outside. This is busted, Dink said as he examined the lock. He tried both handles. See, it doesn't lock at all now. The snow is over my knees. Dink looked around. Maybe they had crashed near a house, stores, anything. But he saw nothing but snow and darkness. His eyes were tearing and his nose felt like it might freeze. Come on, Dink said. Casey left Natasha in the van, commanding her to stay. The five kids struggled around to the driver's door. The van had plowed into a ravine. Its front end was buried in deep snow. The driver's door was buried too. Dink wiped the driver's window with his glove. He peered through the glass. The driver was slumped over the steering wheel. He wasn't moving.